This video will be a little different. This is a wonderfully earnest device made by General Electric, and I use the word earnest because it's clearly a neat idea, but a far from perfect, and to be honest, weird idea. This is the GE Circlite Energy Saving Lamp from 1991. Many of this product's details seem lost to history, probably because they weren't so popular. I mean, this box shows you right here. Started at $10.96, went on clearance for $7, and ended up at Goodwill for $1.99 many years later. Quick note, this isn't what I said my next video was going to be. I'm working on it, I promise, but I wanted to show you this thing. I had originally planned to showcase this in my last video and had it in the first draft of the script, but it got lost in the basement of my parents' house, and only recently could I visit them and find it. So, what is this? Well, it's a not-so-compact fluorescent lamp, or an NSCFL, if you will. It looks as though GE may have been making these things since the 60s in various forms. Really, this is a magnetic ballast and starter plug concealed in this, and I hesitate to call it such, but attractive adapter. You can tell it's a plain old magnetic ballast because it's 1, old, and 2, surprisingly heavy. It drives a 22-watt T9 circline tube, and is meant as an energy-saving alternative to incandescent lamps. Really forward-thinking, and the box has some compelling info on the back. This unit appears to have never been put to use, as the lamp ends aren't darkened at all, and it's in the original carton. So, how does one use this thing? Well, a large part, I'm sure, of why these never took off was the fact that installing them in a lamp could be fairly annoying. You'd need to remove the shade and harp, install the assembled lamp, though the instructions say you should put the tube in after you've screwed the adapter in, which is nothing short of asinine, and then the harp would go through the space between the tube and ballast, and you'd put the shade back on. Cool. But it won't work in a lamp like this, a ceiling fixture like that, or really in a whole bunch of applications. Not exactly universal. Assembling it is somewhat terrifying because this clip is rather tight, and I know fluorescent tubes are stronger than they look, but it still seems like it's going to shatter in my hands when clipping it in. Then you put the little plug in, and you're ready to run it. Because it uses a preheat starter, it starts erratically and differently each time you turn it on, so that's fun. And after it fires up, you'll see the second reason these probably weren't that popular. The phosphor formulation in this tube is awful. Really, really bad. White balance is weird, with it producing a sickly purplish gray light, even though the box assures us it has a warm, pleasing color. Nope. And white balance isn't the biggest issue. Anything under it looks bizarre, with colors being reproduced very strangely. But this was pretty much standard fare for fluorescent lighting of the time. Let's do a quick comparison. I tend to buy all my household items from IKEA because I'm cheap and boring, so I happen to have three identical lamps. Let's load them up with a standard 75-watt incandescent, what this promises to replace, the Energy Choice Miracle device in the middle, and a more modern 60-watt equivalent CFL. Ready? Go! My, what a warm, pleasing color that middle one makes! Well, let's give it a better chance then. One of the real advantages this has over a modern CFL is that the ballast is separate from the tube, so we can replace the tube with something a little less terrible. Off to the hardware store. Here in the US, we describe our fluorescent tubes by their diameter in eighths of an inch. Not sure how the rest of the world does it, but true to American fashion, it's a rather bizarre numbering scheme. The older T12 tube is 1.5 inches diameter, as it's 12/8 of an inch, and the now more standard T8 is 1 inch in diameter. But this thing is a T9, 9/8 of an inch. Not sure why that's a thing, but apparently it's a standard size for circline tubes. Whatever. I'm truly sorry if this is standard convention for the rest of the world, because it's ridiculous. So now that I've got a not terrible tube installed, how does it look? Much better. It's a little cooler than I'd like at 3000K, but at least colors look at least somewhat correct. I think I'll leave this thing in one of my lamps here, as it's plenty bright and a neat novelty every time you switch it on. One thing I can't help but wonder is what will happen when the starter fails. It doesn't seem like you're meant to replace it, and truthfully I don't know if this center bit even comes apart, but I imagine it will last for a very long time. In fact, the box suggests the adapter should last 20 years. If for some reason it won't start a tube anymore, I'll hack this open and see if it's rocking a standard glow plug starter thing or what. Though you can see the starter glow at the bottom of the adapter, so we know for sure it at least has the guts of a standard neon starter plug inside. One interesting note is that because the tube is far away from the center of the adapter, in lamps that will accommodate it, it produces far more light downward than even an ordinary incandescent. This can be useful for lamps such as desk lamps, as it will illuminate the work surface quite well. Thanks for watching, and thank you especially to supporters on Patreon. You can support this channel with a totally voluntary contribution to help keep these videos coming. And with that, I'll see you next time.